Ahoj, sleduješ Basket 101 a tenhle rozhovor s trenérem NBA mi zprostředkoval Lukáš Kuba. Velký díky, sledujte ho na Twitteru a jako vždycky, jestli se vám video bude líbit, dejte like a přihlašte se k odběru. Jdeme na to! So, hello everybody, you are watching Basket 101 and I have a very special guest here today. He is a longtime NBA assistant coach, former head coach of the Denver Nuggets, and most recently, last season, he was the associate head coach of the New Orleans Pelicans. Please allow me to welcome Mr. Jeff Bezdelik. How are you doing, sir?
I am great, and I'm gonna say Dobrý den. Did I say that correctly?
Dobrý den. Yeah, that was pretty good. Yeah, people actually probably know this, but you have some Czech roots, right? Can you just give people a little bit of an introduction what your Czechoslovakian roots are?
Yeah, no, I'm actually Slovak, and my grandfather actually fought in World War One with the Czechoslovakian Legion, I believe it was. When I was growing up, my grandparents spoke Slovak, and we're very proud of our heritage.
I actually want to start with a little bit of history here, but it'll be basketball history, because you worked with Pat Riley for 6 years as an assistant coach in Miami. And obviously Miami this year with the same regime made it all the way to the finals, and much has been written about and talk about this so-called Miami Heat culture. Is this something that was already present in the late 90s when you were there? Could you kind of feel the Heat culture forming?
Pat Riley is a mentor of mine.
I spent actually 7 years with him. The culture, yes, it does exist. It's a culture of discipline. It's a culture of there's one voice. You know, when I say one voice, what happens in the NBA and what happens in basketball, period, is that you have so many voices now, and nothing messes up a player more than just being told different kinds of things from different people. We had a very small staff. I was very fortunate to be with him and to learn from him. And Pat is very disciplined in terms of how he coaches the players. You play very hard, you're held accountable for your effort. We teach very simplistic things. We're gonna do one thing, and defensively, maybe a couple of things, but if they don't work, well, you know what? We're supposed to do it harder and better. So yes, there is a culture there that's quite unique and different than most places.
So in 1997, your Miami Heat won 61 games and you had the best defense in the league, in fact. And then you inevitably lost in the playoffs to Michael Jordan, as did everyone. What do you remember about game planning for MJ defensively?
Yes, Michael Jordan, we did a great job with, they always ran that triangle offense, and we did a great job knowing the options that existed within the triangle offense. We did a great job of defending. But what really hurt us was at the end of the shot clock, when Michael just cleared everybody out and just really created on his own off the dribble. And if he was double teamed and someone came over to help, he would find great shooters, you know, like Steve Kerr, for example, John Paxson, Scottie Pippen. Yeah, it was very difficult to stop him at the end of the shot clock when time was running down.
Okay, let's take a look at the first clips here. Let's take a look at this. We'll start with your Pelicans from last season, right before the NBA shutdown. Let's take a look at your basic pick and roll defense here. Can you please briefly explain what your pick and roll coverage here is and why you chose this specific scheme for your team?
Well, we call this a catch. First of all, let's start. There's a lot of things going on here, because what people have to realize, it takes all five players to get a stop. First of all, let's start with the ball. You need to, if you're guarding the ball, you need to be above the arc. Our defender here is above the arc, because you can't let people just walk into three. So Derek Favors, who is our center at this point, he is at the free throw line. He's in a catch position. In other words, he's 2 to 3 big steps below the level of the screener. He's going to call out the pick, and he's going to say right, 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 right. So when that happens, when you're guarding the ball, you hear the call, you got to get into the ball. That's our saying, hear the call, get into the ball. So that defender's got to take one big step up with his left foot and force the ball handler to go into the coverage. And he needs to get over the screen. You take Drew Holiday, who's up on the left slot, for example. He can take a step in. The two corner defenders, they're taking a step in to pinch in. So you got to show a crowded lane.
The thing you mentioned with Drew is actually exactly what I wanted to ask about, because he does this hard stunt, I guess you would call it,
yeah.
Or dig.
You know, if we stop right there, See, Drew is in. He's showing a crowded lane right there. Derek, our center, he's in a catch, and what his job is to move his feet in such a way that he's keeping the ball from getting to the rim, but at the same time, he's not allowing the roller to get behind him. So he can kind of play both the ball and the roller. That is a great job because we're forcing a tough shot, a one-legged runner that's not a layup, we're not fouling, and we're not giving up a three.
I was going to ask that because he actually makes the shot, but I was going to ask, this is pretty much a job well done, right, by your guys, by the defense?
Absolutely. You know, those kinds of shots are not going to beat you. And let's face it, NBA players are very good. They're going to make tough shots. But those kinds of shots aren't going to beat you because they're not open threes, they're not free throws, and they're not layups. And those, again, are the three best analytic shots. If you were to ask an offensive coach, what do you want to get on offense? They would say, we want open threes, layups, and free throws.
This year, you are defending the best offense in the league, right? The Mavericks.
Correct.
And this position is an absolute minefield where so much can go wrong for you. There is the five out spacing, there's the pick and roll with both the guys are threats from all over the place. So I guess my first question, are you okay with KP being open up there? Is this something you will live with?
Yeah, no, I can tell you exactly what happened here. This is really good. If we stop it right there, I can explain some things. If we go back, you know, just remember back to the first clip. And remember we had Derek Favors, our center, in a catch, and he was at the free throw line. Because he was guarding a center who was a roller. But in this, so we had him back, and we called that a catch. In this particular case, yes, you're right. We're playing the number one offense in the league. You got Doncic, and you got Porzingis. And there's no easy answer here. And they have shooters in the corner. So we can't have our big way back there, because if Porzingis sets a good pick, they're going to clip Drew, and Doncic is going to go downhill on our big, or he's going to stop and he's going to shoot a three, and that's not good. If our center, Derek Favors, is way back, then Porzingis is just going to flare out and he's going to get airspace, and that's not good.
Yeah.
So we got to, in this particular case, we got to have our big up. You know, Doncic, guards don't like to see crowds. And so Doncic, when he comes off, he's going to see a crowd. He can't turn the corner and he can't shoot a three. Two things can happen here. Derek should immediately maybe release and go back to Porzingis. But he stays with him a little too long. And you know, it's difficult because you've got a great player there. And he wants to make sure that Drew can recover and get back in front. What really should have happened here, the bottom guy in the corner there, that's Brandon. Brandon should have been cheating up. And Brandon should have been almost at the elbow, the left elbow. He should be right there. Because what he can do on a pass back is he can stunt at Porzingis. And then when he stunts, he recovers down the arc. And that allows, that buys Derek a second to get back to Porzingis. Brandon didn't do his job. He just kind of stayed there. The other thing, too, is maybe Derek should have just said switch, and Drew could have gotten back to Porzingis, and then Derek would have had to take Doncic.
Yeah, eventually happened.
Now, once we do all this, when Doncic gives up the ball, what Derek's got to do is, as soon as Doncic gives it up, is he's got to full face deny Doncic the ball back. And we used to do that against Steph Curry when I was associate head coach of the Houston Rockets. And sometimes you need to do that against pick and roll players like Porzingis and Doncic, is just switch so that neither one can get airspace. There are a couple of mistakes there. We should have denied it, maybe communicated better to switch or not, and Brandon needed to stunt.
These also illustrate very well that sometimes you can do everything right and still get scored on, and other times like this you can make a couple of mistakes and eventually that's a miss and you're gonna luck out. So people shouldn't only focus on the result, right? It's always about the process,
right? And you know, and I think that's the biggest thing that, you know, winning teams do, is you stay the course in terms of what you do, try and get as many great defensive possessions as you can. And you know, again, transition defense, blocking off, not fouling, All those things add up to the course of the game.
All right. So let's get back to that last season with the Pelicans a little bit. Your team had a great stretch just before the season was shut down in March. Can you remember kind of what caused it? Was it just Zion getting healthy, or was it anything else that clicked? Because you had a really nice run there in March.
Yeah, I think there were several factors. Number one, when you add a player like Zion, you're going to look like better coaches. That's number one. Number two, though, we had a lot of injuries. Derek Favors was out early on. Drew Holiday was out early on. And we never were able to practice or play with our best players. And, of course, with a team for the first time, as a new staff, you need the time to develop your habits. So you need healthy bodies every day in practice to develop habits. You know, we really got our defense going around Christmas time. We got people healthy. Our offense was clicking, and everything. As a young team, we were developing good habits.
You, of course, didn't travel with the team to the bubble for obvious reasons. What is the strangest thing that you can remember about remote coaching? Is there any particular story or anything? How did it go?
Well, yeah, no, it's spending a lot of time in the computer. I was with the team all the time, going through game plans, breaking down practice films. They would practice and send me the film through the technology, and I was able to break down the practice and offer advice and, you know, text players and that kind of thing. So it was a unique and strange time, but I was the third oldest coach in the league. So, you know,
there was no other way, right?
Yeah, there was, mm-hmm. was no other way.
One more question about Zion. If you try to remember maybe your first practice with Zion in the preseason, what jumped out at you first, either good or bad?
You know, Zion, he's a wonderful human being. He wants to win. He's a great competitor. His mind is right. He's a great competitor, but at the same time, you know, he's been injured, you know, four times in about a year and a half, and so he really needs to just get healthy.
Okay, fine. So I have three more clips here, so I am sure you remember this very well. In 2018, your Houston Rockets came the closest that anyone has ever really come to defeating the Warriors at full strength, right? You were up 3-2 when Chris Paul got unfortunately hurt, and you, sir, were the architect behind the Rockets defense that almost managed to beat the Warriors. So I have to ask you about it.
We felt that the best thing to do against the Golden State Warriors was to switch. And here's the reasons why. Number one, Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, Kevin Durant. I mean, you can just go on and on and on. They're great shooters. They really do a good job in setting screens and working really hard to get open shots. So the best thing to do is to take away their biggest weapon, and that's shooting the ball, is by switching. And when we switched, we wanted to be aggressive. Switch to deny, switch to take away threes, and switch to force turnovers. And also couple that with the fact that the Houston Rockets were built for switching. We had strong, communicative guys, James Harden, Eric Gordon, Chris Paul. Those guys are physical, they're strong.
They can guard. Ariza, right?
Yeah, and also too, our bigs could move their feet. So we felt switching would be our best way to beat them, and it almost worked. You have to talk it, touch it, switch it, deny it. In other words, you can't point switch. You can't switch lazily. You have to be aggressive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can see that here actually, right? Where after the switch, Chris Paul tries to actually front KD and deny him the ball, and he actually ends up getting the turnover. This is a clip where switching actually puts you in a tough position because you have Clint Capella, your big poor guy, on an island 1-on-1 against Steph Curry. As you are watching this from the bench, and we can actually see you right there on the bench, what is going through your head when you see a poor guy like Capella in this situation?
All right, well, you know, hey, sometimes it's not too bad because Clint can move his feet. He's in a really good stance. We're trying to push Curry to his left. He's just a little less effective going to his left. And what Clint's job is to do is to force Curry to play inside the arc. You know, Clint's job is not let him shoot a three and force him to take tough shots over Clint's length.
He actually gets the block, but I'm gonna back it up because even though he gets the highlight play, it's not really the most important play, right? I'm gonna stop it right here And talk to me about who made the key play, because like you said, it takes all five players, right? So
right. Now look at our players off the lane. We have a nice crowded lane. You know, you have some guys you can take some liberties off of. Maybe Draymond Green. Mm-hmm. We can shrink the court off of certain players that mm-hmm. aren't shooters. There are shooters that we want to stay attached to. But as Curry drives, Clint is forcing Curry to play fast off the dribble inside the arc, and yet we have a crowded lane. Who is that? Chris Paul right there?
Yeah, that's CP. Mm-hmm. That's CP.
Yeah, CP is taking liberties off his man and showing a crowded lane. So Curry's got no place to go. We also have PJ in the lane, and then we got another player, I believe that's Eric Gordon. He's on the right block, so we have a nice crowded lane in there.
I thought the help defense here was especially good by CP, and when we go on a little bit, then it's Eric Gordon, right, stepping up.
Yeah, Eric's there early. Again, we go back to what's your goal defensively? No layups, no open threes, and no fouls, and we did a really good job of that.
So this is a play that the Warriors love. Draymond gets the ball in the either low post or mid post or high post. And there's going to be KD cutting through the lane and Steph running off screen and a lot of off ball motion. And we also saw Miami use it effectively this year with Duncan Robinson and Tyler Hero. But somehow you managed to shut it down here. And I'm just interested in your perspective of what you did that was so
sure.
effective.
Well, we practice this a lot. What you want to do when Draymond Green is in the post, there is absolutely no help. He doesn't want to score. When he gets the ball in the post, everybody else, the four other players, need to be on high alert. They know that Draymond is looking for a cutter. So you need to make sure when the ball goes into the post, the first thing you want to do is you want to get into the body of the four other guys and understand that they're going to cut and they're going to screen. And your job is to not let them get the ball. In this particular case, the entry passer, he just cut. You get into his body and you understand he cannot get a pass back. Now, we talked about, they're going to try and run a post split. What's the counter for switching? You know, you're not going to set a screen. You might slip a screen. You might fake a screen. You know, you want to create indecision, and that goes back to our rules defensively switching, and that is you do not switch unless you talk it, which means you and I are communicating. We come together. That prevents any slippage from slipping. Mm-hmm. So you talk it, you touch it, you switch it, you grab it is how we phrased it. And then you see with Curry way up on top, you know, we're up and into him, you know, knowing that we don't want him to even catch the ball.
So these clips showed that defense is an extremely complex mechanism and kind of hard to evaluate without the eye test. Are you a fan of any defensive stat? Is there anything that you believe, or is defense just completely about eye test and film study?
No, I think that, you know, first of all, defensive transition starts with offense. The highest percentage of scoring, it comes early in the shot clock. So you have to be really rock solid on your defensive transition. And, you know, everything's connected. And so it starts with taking good shots and not turning the ball over. And we had a problem with that with the Pelicans. Our offense, we turned the ball over the worst in the league and yielding points off turnovers. And then, you know, defensive rebound percentage is a big judge of defense. Mm-hmm. You know, the Chicago Bulls, when they had Michael Jordan and Pippen and Rodman, they were always the number one defensive rebound percentage team in the league. The teams only got one shot. And then, you know, I think, you know, fouling. Toughness is defending without fouling. 90% of fouls are defensive mistakes because you're in bad position. Mm-hmm. So in answer to your question, I would say really defensive rebound percentage. Mm-hmm. Everybody's got a rebound first before you can run. That's number one. Number two, defend without fouling. And then the third thing is you have to take away something. And I really believe you got to defend the paint. Being able to defend the paint and limiting paint points and being in early and then arriving on the catch when they kick it out for threes. Those are some major stats that I think are indicators for sound defense.
Who's the smartest player that you have ever coached?
You know, Chris Paul is very, very smart. He really has a great ability to see things before they happen. Defensively, he communicates great. He has an awareness. PJ Tucker is someone else too that defensively has great awareness to him and really has an understanding of how to communicate, positioning himself early, and also those things are essential. But here's the most essential thing: your competitive spirit to guard, your willingness to be able to want to defend and take pride in defending. Defense is extremely hard work, and you have to have the mentality to do it all the time, and you have to take great pride in studying your opponent, limiting his opportunities. Dan Majerle is an old school guy that was that way as well.
Mm-hmm. And you also coached Tony Allen, didn't you, in Memphis?
Yes. Mm. You know, I'm glad you... I'm sorry. Thank you for reminding me. Tony Allen, good gracious, he has such great pride. He's one of those guys that had the instinct to invite a pass and get the steal. He had the bravado and the competitive spirit to really just want to shut people down. I've been coaching 45 years. I've been very blessed to be around a lot of great players, and I know Alonzo Mourning, for example, who was Defensive Player of the Year one of the years I was there. PJ Brown, Dan Majerle, Tony Allen, Marc Gasol is another one, mm-hmm. who has a great understanding of personnel, intelligence, and a will and a want to. And that's Trevor Ariza is another one. You know, we always say Pat Riley would always say it's a will and a want to.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Really want to and will yourself to do it.
Right, so, right. Okay, all right. The very last thing I want to talk about briefly. You were there at the beginning of Carmelo Anthony's career. You were the head coach of the Nuggets in his rookie and sophomore year. And then you had the chance again to coach him when he spent a few months with the Rockets, like 15 years later. How does it make you feel watching him heading towards a Hall of Fame career, knowing that you were there at the beginning and you probably taught him a lot of things that he still like utilizes? Is there pride, or is there, what is there?
Yes, you know, Carmelo is one of my favorite people. I think one of the things that you go back to that first year, his rookie year, we inherited a team that was in transition, and the year before they had only won 17 games. They wanted to tear it down and create that Miami Heat culture, and the Nuggets had not been in the playoffs for 9 straight years. And we, at Carmelo Anthony's rookie year, we made the playoffs. We had the 6th best turnaround in NBA history, and we made the playoffs, the Nuggets did, for the first time in a decade. And then they went on to have 10 straight years of being in the playoffs. And Carmelo was a big factor, a huge factor, and very instrumental in changing that culture. And you know what? Dwayne Wade and LeBron James did not make the playoffs as rookies that year, but yet Carmelo did. And we did it in the Western Conference, which was extremely tough. You know, and Carmelo and I would talk about that. And I've thanked him many, many times that, you know, for the job that he did. He's a wonderful young man. He's matured a lot over the years. And he's had a Hall of Fame career. So very thankful for having the opportunity to coach him.
Okay, Mr. Brzelek, I'm afraid this is all I have. Thank you very much for doing this. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate your time. Is there anything you want to tell my audience?
Well, listen, I am very proud of my Slovak heritage, and I follow the countries in the news and what's going on there all the time. We even have Slovak keychains for our cars.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very proud of our history with our family. And
all right. Again, thank you very much. Take care, and see you hopefully at some point in the future. Bye bye.
All right. Dovidenia. Correct. Dovidenia.
Dovidenia. Yeah. Naschle. Dovidenia.
All right. Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye bye.